Michael Moore is here. 20 years ago, he took on General Motors and its relationship with his hometown of Flint, Michigan. The documentary is called Roger and Me. Since then, his films have covered topics ranging from gun control, the Iraqi war, and health care. His new film looks critically at the American economic system. It is called Capitalism, A Love Story, and here is the trailer.
This is Michael Moore. I am here to make a citizen's arrest of the board of directors of AIG.
From Michael Moore.
We're actually here to make a citizen's arrest.
Speak to my supervisor.
In the white shirt?
Yep.
Blue tie?
That's it.
Receding hairline?
The guy who brought you Bowling for Columbine, Fahrenheit 9/11, and Sicko.
What else do you want to leave the building?
Your cameraman and your crew.
Oh,
come on out.
All right,
sir.
They don't speak English. Donde?
This fall, the most feared filmmaker in America.
Can I talk to you, sir, for a second? Can you tell me what a credit default swap is? Can you explain a derivative to me?
Will reveal what happens when Wall Street tanks.
Stock markets crash.
Bankruptcy.
Foreclosures.
A global meltdown.
And the government bails.
By spending just a few million dollars to buy Congress, Wall Street was given billions.
The motion is adopted.
You know who Michael Moore is, don't you, Betty? The film director, he's filming me right now.
How did this collapse happen?
I got home on a Friday. Everything was just fine. I called back after my plane landed in Indiana, and all of a sudden we've got this crisis on our hands.
There's got to be some kind of a rebellion between the people that have nothing and the people that's got it all.
Everything was being handled by the Treasury Secretary from Goldman Sachs. They had Congress right where they wanted them. This was almost like an intelligence operation.
This is straight up capitalism.
Boom. Where's our money?
I don't know.
The people here really aren't in charge.
I guess you win.
We want our money back.
Capitalism offers people the freedom to choose where they work.
There isn't anything in here. I'm not going to be a gentleman's club hire dancer.
We're here to get the money back for the American people. I got more bags. 10 billion probably won't fit in here.
I'm pleased to have Michael Moore back at this table. Welcome, sir.
Thank you for having me here.
So now, what's wrong with capitalism? I thought we liked capitalism.
Well, probably at one point it wasn't a bad idea. You know, open up a store, sell shoes.
Exactly.
You know, I need shoes. You need shoes.
Exactly.
I'm not going to make the shoes. So
exactly.
Somebody's
right.
Got to make them.
You know,
somebody's...
if they need a little profit, that's a good idea.
Yeah, well,
work
yeah,
hard,
yeah,
support
because,
the family.
Yeah,
it sounds like a good system.
You
to
make a little bit, then what you do is you make the shoe store a little better. Maybe make
exactly.
The shoes a little better.
Exactly.
You know? And you create jobs,
yeah.
Which then those people are able to take their money and buy shoes.
Exactly.
Which creates more jobs,
yeah,
that's the way it used to roll. But.
Right.
But
that's
some,
what Henry Ford hoped would happen. Everybody
right.
would be able to make enough money off an assembly line so they could buy a Ford.
Well, that is what happened.
Right.
And once the workers at Ford and GM and other places organized into unions and started negotiating, sometimes going on strike, they got wages that were that put them into a new class called the middle class. It didn't exist before.
Right.
And that's gone. That's really gone to a very large extent now. The middle class has been decimated. People do not live their lives assured that they will have a job next year, that they're going to have the money to send their kids to college, whether they'll be able ever to pay off the mortgage. That's not the way it was with my dad. I'm sure it wasn't the way with yours
wasn't.
Either.
my father came out of the Great Depression, so I mean he was...
Right. As did mine,
yeah.
and he bought his first house after he got out of the Marines in World War II.
Same with
came,
my father.
Yep, right. Came home and by the time I was in kindergarten, it was paid off.
My father would never buy anything except cash. I mean, he was so scared of the implications
mm-hmm.
of credit.
Right.
At
right.
that time.
Yes, debt was a bad thing.
Exactly.
It was really, and it was something, especially coming out of the Depression, something you really wanted to avoid at all costs. Having done that, though, they were able to raise their families, to send their kids to school. My dad had a new Chevy every 3 years.
Yeah.
And that was all, and he didn't have a college education. I mean, it was all from his labor, all from
right.
his sweat.
Right.
And in the old days, capitalism was about you made your money either from your labor or from your ideas. Or from the next great invention that mm-hmm. you happened to come up with. And you were rewarded for that. In the last 20 years, it's been about making money off money, not about making things. It's about how can I move this money around, mm-hmm. take bets on the money,
yeah.
take bets on the
yeah.
bets. I don't think this is anything really radical
exactly.
that I am
my
saying
point.
Here. And in fact, When people say to me, well, if you don't like capitalism, at least the version of capitalism that we have now, what do you propose? And my answer is that I'm not suggesting we have to come up with something brand new. Actually, if we just applied some of the old principles that we used to have, democratic values, that in other words, where the people have some say in how the economy is run, not just the wealthiest 1% that now has more financial worth than the bottom 95% combined. I mean, this is a crazy system where the 1% have more than the 95%. I mean, that is, to me, in a democracy, in a free society, in a society that says it believes in free enterprise and a free market and all that, it certainly has benefited just a very few people. Yeah. And when you do that, it's called a pyramid scheme. Because only a few people can sit on top of the pyramid. Yeah. Their job is to convince everybody else in the pyramid to work really hard, because maybe you too can be up there in the pyramid with me someday. But of course, we all know that's not going
to
happen.
And that disparity between the two has grown over the last, say, 10 years?
Oh, yeah. I mean, all the statistics, I mean, show that gap has widened, that the middle class has been squeezed. I mean, right now, Charlie, there is a foreclosure filing in this country once every 7.5 seconds. One out of every 8 homes in this country is in either delinquency or foreclosure. This is an epidemic.
Two things that you have said. Number one, you call this capitalism a love story. What's the love story?
What's the love part? Huh? Yeah. And why do we have the R rating?
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. It's not Wall Street bankers making love to their piles of money, but it is a version of that.
Yes.
The love part is that the wealthy, Charlie, they love their money.
Well, yes.
But the twist here is that they don't just love their money, they love our money too. They want everybody's money.
Yeah.
And they have created a system where for 20, 30 years now, workers, average everyday working people, have had to cut back on their wages, cut back on their benefits, cut back on their days off, cutbacks, 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 all at a time where during this period, the Dow Jones has gone up and up and up, where the wealthy have become much more wealthy, and everybody else is having to work, you know, if they are working, for longer hours for less pay.
All right. You also said that this is, that capitalism has become, essentially what you're saying, a legalized system of greed.
Yes.
It's legal
yes.
to be greedy.
Yes.
But greedy was never a legal concept anyway, was it?
No, greed is part of human nature.
It's a moral question.
And it's always been with us.
Right.
Long before capitalism, long before the United States of America, there was greed. Yeah. But
it was never illegal, so you didn't have to legalize it. It was always there.
No, but I think we decided a long time ago as a society, realizing the dark sides of our human nature, greed, violence, you know, other things, that we set up certain structures, certain restrictions on ourselves, so that we behave. Capitalism is not a restriction on greed. Capitalism actually encourages it. Encourages you to think about me, myself, and I. What can I do to get ahead? Let's look at the bottom line, and let's never ask the question, is this good for the people? Is this for the common good? If that question were asked more often, if we would actually behave as the Judeo-Christian nation we like to think of ourselves as, these values that we purport to have, I got to believe that we wouldn't allow a lot of what has happened to take place.
I do think this. I mean, my father had a small business in a small town, that there are millions and millions of people who engage in the capitalistic enterprise, you know, who are not operating on some idea of greed.
No, these
and,
are,
you're not
small
saying
business.
That. You're
talking
about
that is
people who are at the top of the financial system.
Top of the pyramid.
Top
the Ponzi
of the pyramid.
Scheme. The big Ponzi scheme that we call our economic system now. Bernie Madoff was like a great poster boy and a distraction, really, for, you know, let's focus all our anger on him when, as far as I'm concerned, this whole system is set up to make sure that the people at the very, very top get away like with bandits. Now, look at the story in the New York Times this week. Front page of the Times, the story of the Simmons Beauty Rest mattress company.
It's an amazing story. It was a brilliant reporting.
Yes.
Take a look at this clip. This is where you trace the roots of Wall Street's entanglement with the federal government back to the relationship between President Reagan and Don Regan, who was his Secretary of the Treasury and later his Chief of Staff.
See that guy standing next to the president? You know, the one that looks like a butler? His name was Don Regan, the chairman of Merrill Lynch, the richest and biggest retail brokerage firm in the world. He took the key position of Treasury Secretary so he could enact the tax cuts that the rich wanted. Regan then became White House Chief of Staff as the president started to fade.
Then they should give the president what 43 governors have, a line item veto.
And speed it up.
Who tells the president to speed it up? The band from Merrill Lynch, that's who. Things in America would never be the same again. The country would now be run like a corporation.
We're going to turn the bull loose.
So your point here is about Don Regan?
In this case, with Ronald Reagan, I think that there were, that he, again, when they come in and they say they're going to be the CEO president, they're going to delegate this stuff. They mean it. And they really come in. Reagan came in and delegated to Don Regan and others, who then set about essentially destroying our union workforce in this country, the wages that people were being paid. You know, wages since that time, the workers' wages, real wages, have essentially remained stagnant. It's gone up like 1%. But productivity since Reagan has gone up 45%. So basically what they did was they got rid of workers, and then with the remaining workers at, say, a car factory, they had them try to do the same amount of work that, say, two people on the line used to do. Now one person will do both jobs, and of course the company can save money,
right?
Because they're not having to pay the second employee.
Okay, but let me understand the theory about Don Regan. So Don Regan, in a sense, who'd been former CEO of Merrill Lynch,
right?
Your point is that he came there not out of personal ambition, not because he wanted to serve the country. He'd been a former Marine and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
He came there because
he was doing what Wall Street wanted. They wanted to turn things around. They wanted their own taxes cut, because at that point they were paying the top marginal rates for the super wealthy were up to 70% at that point. They wanted those cut in half, and they got them cut in half, right down to 35%. First 39% and then 35%. So that's the first thing they wanted. The second thing they wanted was they wanted to bust unions, and they started off by making a very good and strong...
Even though the president had been a former union...
Well, but he was long ago turned his back on the democratic politics that he believed in, the union that he was the president of. He was no longer that individual. And so workers have not had it very good for the last 30 years, ever since. And I show in the movie all the different statistics of since, you know, when Reagan... From Reagan's time on, how it's gotten worse for working families and a hell of a lot better for people with money.
And this carried through the Clinton administration?
Absolutely.
Yeah. The Clinton administration didn't do anything to stop the trend?
No.
An indictment of the former president?
They actually cut the taxes back. Well, I think I wrote in my first book that that Clinton was the best Republican president we've ever had, better than Lincoln. There's a lot of things about Clinton I really liked. I mean, I feel the guy got a bad shake for a lot of the time that he was there in office. But sadly, he probably figured, because, you know, he never got a majority of the votes with Ross Perot, when he won. I mean, what did Clinton got? 38% of the total vote. Perot got 19%.
Right.
So he couldn't really govern with the vast majority that Obama has right now. And so I think he probably had to play it.
So that was 92. Then in 94,
and then
the
94,
Reagan,
the
revolution came in the Congress.
He loses Congress.
Right.
So by 96, he's like, okay, I'm not going to stay here if I don't play ball. And so he does more of really what the Republicans want to see happen than people on the other side.
That's when he said the era of big government is over.
Yeah, and the, you know, which is basically he was trying to put a stake through the heart of Franklin Roosevelt. And and if it wasn't for Roosevelt, we wouldn't have the great country that we have right now.
The reason your movies do well at the box office is because you have a very interesting way of telling a story. So let's take a look at this clip.
The scam to swindle people out of the homes they already owned was masterful. Here's how it worked. First, tell these homeowners that they own a bank. And that bank is your home. So if your home is worth $250,000, that makes you a quarter millionaire. You're sitting on a gold mine. You own your own bank, the bank of you. And you could use your bank to get more money. Just refinance. Everyone's doing it. Of course, hidden in the dozens or hundreds of pages of fine print are tricky clauses that allow the bank to raise your interest rate to a number you didn't know about, perhaps so high that you won't be able to repay your loan. But that's okay. If you can't repay it, we'll just take your house.
You were saying during the break, you don't have no stock. You have no shares of stock.
No, I don't own a share of stock.
Because you made a lot of money.
Yeah, well, I've done well, yes. I mean, for a documentary filmmaker, yes, I've done
very
well.
But you made $240 million.
Yeah, well, that didn't go to me. Trust me.
You got $200 million out of that.
The auditors are currently looking for where the money went. But
you've made a lot.
Yes,
You're the most successful documentary filmmaker in the history of film.
Thank you. What do I win?
I don't know. I assume you want a trip to the bank, but...
Yes, I've been able to send my daughter to college, and I've been able to live in a nice home in Michigan, and you know, all those.
You still
things.
Live in Flint? Where do you live?
We live north of northern Michigan.
Right.
I've been very fortunate with all that, but I'm very conservative, I guess, when it comes to, I don't believe in casinos, and you know, the stock market to me is a casino. I don't know why you would put your money, especially your retirement funds, in something that could just vaporize. It just never made any sense to me. So, I try to live conservatively like that.
At the end of this film, you make the challenge that unless people actually mobilize and do something to affect change, you will stop making films.
I'll stop making documentaries, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, that's
unless
the challenge.
Unless people mobilize for change, what's the change they have to mobilize for to keep you from stopping making films?
Well, look, I've been doing this for 20 years, okay? I mean, it's a bit of like, I feel like I'm beating my head against the wall. 20 years ago, I tried to warn people about General Motors.
Right. That's when we met.
That's right, and a lot of good that did us, because nothing really changed, and now we have a bankrupt General Motors.
So what do you think about the rescue of General Motors?
I didn't like the initial bailout money going to the same people that caused the problem. That was just that first set of money that they got went right down the rat hole.
Right.
I love the fact that President Obama is the de facto chairman of the board now, and that he fired the CEO. That was good. And I think that President Obama has a good vision.
You would have been in favor at the end trying to do something to rescue General Motors because of the jobs that would be lost and people who would be worse off if they were not.
Yes, to rescue the industrial infrastructure of this country, which should be seen as a national security issue. If we allow our factories to just go the way of the dinosaurs here, we're going to need those factories someday. We're going to need them to build new transportation, to build alternative energy, and if we destroy that workforce, I mean, that is such a bad idea for the country. So I favor anything we can do to help that, because those people actually make things.
Now, suppose that includes what goes under the rubric of protectionism. Are you in favor of that or against that?
Protectionism means
tariffs and things that you do in order to protect your own industries.
Well, first of all, there's no such thing as an American car anymore because they're filled with foreign parts and et cetera. In fact, there are some Toyotas and Hondas that are more American built here than an American
because
car
built
here.
Because they got tax breaks from certain states to locate in those states.
What I would have done 20 or 30 years ago is I would have pushed for legislation that prohibited companies like General Motors from closing factories in cities like Flint and moving them to Mexico and throwing all these people out of work here, which caused a huge burden on our society. Not alone just what it did to the actual people themselves and their families and the destructive force that it created. General Motors has a right to go build factories in Mexico, but go build factories there and build cars for Mexicans and pay Mexicans wages so they can afford to buy those cars. But that's not what they did. They went there and they built cars or parts or whatever so that it could be shipped back here. And this never made any sense to me. Never, I don't understand. It's like, I mean, I only had a semester of economics in high school, but I remember some really basic things that if you throw the auto workers out of work, who's going to buy your cars?
Right.
Who's going to buy the cars?
Back to Henry Ford, huh?
Yeah, it made no sense. And of course, that's exactly what happened by killing the middle class. They didn't have the people to buy the cars, and they were never really forced to build the kind of cars people wanted. And so therefore, now we're in the situation we're in with General Motors.
You say we need a democratic economic system.
Right.
Draw me a picture of a democratic economic system.
An economic system that is controlled by the people, that's controlled by the people who we elect to represent us. Right now, you and I and most of the people watching the show have very little say as to how this economy is run, the decisions that get made. That has to be vested much more in our hands and in our representatives' hands than in the hands of Wall Street the way it is now. Wall Street, the investment bank, bankers, the Fed, et cetera. This is not, if we say, I can't call this a democracy if it's just I get to vote every 2 to 4 years, so I want, it's a democracy. but yet it's not a democracy in the economy. Our workplace is not a democracy. What parts of our lives do we really have democracy other than these every couple years where I get to go behind a curtain and plunk down for somebody? I mean, I want real, true democracy in this country, and I want it in all facets of our lives. I want us to have a say. That's so basic, and it's so American. It's like the patriotic thing to do would be to support democracy in our economy, support democracy in the workplace. I mean, the people that work, you know, I've been thinking about this because in my own business, I have a business, obviously, because I'm making movies. And I've been thinking, geez, you know, maybe I should set the business up so that the people who work at the business actually have a say in this and share the profits, if there are any, of this business.
You strongly supported President Obama.
Yes.
Correct?
Absolutely. Yes.
And President Obama selected Larry Summers.
Yes.
And Tim Geithner.
Right.
And Elizabeth Warren, who we both admire as well,
right,
is now sort of working to oversee on the part of Congress.
Yes.
To oversee the TARP money. Yes.
Right. Correct.
So what's the disconnect here? Do you know something Barack Obama doesn't know, as smart as you've given him credit for?
Well, he doesn't consult me every morning like he does Larry Summers. And
well, no, I'm serious, you know, because you...
Is there
a contradiction here that you believe...
It could be a contradiction. It on the surface, it doesn't look good. And as soon as I heard that he had hired them, I thought, well, you know, the large banks, they hire bank robbers to help advise them for how to prevent
them from stealing the money.
Yes. So who better to bring in than the guys?
You didn't think this.
The guys who helped to create the mess, you know,
yeah,
make them clean up their own mess, you know.
Yeah.
That probably wasn't it, was it?
No.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't that.
Yeah. Well, you know, let's just say the jury is out right now. The jury's about ready to come back in. somebody asked me the other day, how long are you going to give Obama? I said, well, to the beginning of the NBA season, you know, so not
no,
the preseason.
So you're having real questions about the choices
course.
He's made?
I'm concerned about this. I'm sure he came in there. He inherits this incredible mess. I mean, a catastrophe
right.
that he didn't create.
Right.
And now he's got to fix it really quick. And he was probably just like the rest of us who a year ago could define credit default swap.
Yeah, okay. But exactly.
You know, I mean,
Well, define credit default swap for us while you're here.
Let me tell you an interesting story that I've not shared publicly, but because I couldn't get him to come in and be on the film. But I ran into a former member of the Fed, of the board.
Right.
And he tells me this story. That the day that they had a guy come in one day to explain credit default swaps to the Fed board.
Right.
And he's sitting there, and he says, I'm sitting there, I don't understand a damn word.
When is this? Who's chairman? Greenspan is chairman, Ben Bernanke is chairman?
No, Greenspan is chairman.
Okay.
And he's on, you know, there's 9 Fed boards around the country in the different regions, you know, Philadelphia, San Francisco, et cetera. So he's on one of these 9, right, one of the 9 Fed boards. And he said, I sat there and I was afraid to like ask any questions. I couldn't understand a damn word the guy was saying.
So this is a member of the Fed board.
Yes. So after the crash last September, a year ago, he called up one of his old buddies who was on the board with him. And he said, remember that day the guy came in to define credit default swaps to us? I didn't understand what he was saying. Did you understand? He goes, no, I didn't understand either. He said, I wonder, and then they asked a couple others. Nobody in the room knew what this guy was saying. These are the guys that are on
I agree with that. I mean, that's an interesting point now, because I think that I think that happened at a lot of boards of directors of financial companies, too.
Right.
Here is the question.
Yeah.
Is it the economic system that needs to be fixed or the political system?
Well, that's a good question.
At long last.
Yeah. it's a bit of both. I don't know if the so-called economic system can be fixed at this point. They say we just need to put some regulations on it, Charlie, and we'll get it back to normal.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? It's been over a year since the crash. How many regulations has Congress passed? Zero. They're not going to pass any regulations.
Yeah.
The banking lobby, they have poured so many millions of dollars to stop any of this. And now, what are they doing now? They're off doing new derivatives on life insurance policies. I mean, they've concocted, they will not stop. This is like a hungry beast.
The securitization continues.
Absolutely, and it will continue, and there will be more crashes. There's other shoes we've been waiting for them to drop. The credit card debt that is out of control, commercial real estate bubble that's going to crash. All these things are going to happen. Who's in charge? What's going on? I just see these guys making more money, more bonuses, and nobody seems to be minding the shop.
Nobody in government or in
Nobody
Wall Street?
Nobody in government. Well, Wall Street is not going to mind. You're asking the foxes to mind their own hen house. That's not going to happen.
You don't put the foxes in charge of the chicken coop.
But that's essentially what I feel we have when you have the Rubins and the Summers and these guys still around.
We'll see a revolution in the country.
It doesn't have so much to do with whether I want to see it. It's happening.
Okay, fair enough.
I think it's happening. Seriously. I think there is something boiling beneath the surface out there. There is an anger. You can't throw that many people out of their homes.
Oh, I agree.
You can't have...
I don't know how you measure it, but there is clearly a sense of...
I can tell you...
The system doesn't work for me.
Yes, and traveling the country and making this film and listening to people, Well, you started to see it a little bit this summer at the town hall meetings and, you know, these teabag things. And the right is doing a very good job of trying to harness that anger and take it in their direction.
Right.
The left, the other side of the political fence, needs to offer a hand out to these people who are suffering. Because if we don't have any answers, if we just look like, meet the new boss, same as the old boss, they're going to be just as disappointed and probably more so in President Obama and this Democratic Congress, because there's so much expectation and hope right now that they're going to turn things around. And if President Obama, if he goes back on any of that, if he just does the same thing that the others have done, I will hate to see that happen, because so many young people got behind this. So many young people have, for this last year or so, have been filled with this sense of hope and urgency that we're going to have a new day in America. And if that doesn't happen, if he lets that dissipate, if their wishes and dreams get dashed like that, and turn them into cynics instead of hopeful citizens, he will have done more damage than anything else he's doing right now. Because the last thing I want to see is somebody who's 22 years old go, "What's the use? Yeah, they're all politicians. I'm not getting involved anymore in that." That would be devastating for our democracy. And I'm begging President Obama to not let that happen.
Well, I'm with you on that. Capitalism, A Love Story, is in theaters now.